Good evening and welcome to the second event in the 2009-2010 Humanities Lecture Series. I'm Victor Bailey, Director of the Hall Centre, which organises the series. It's our great privilege this evening to bring you foreign correspondent, radio commentator and author T.R. Reid. Tonight's event is co-sponsored by the Madison and Lila Self Graduate Fellowship and by Kansas Public Radio. It's also made possible by the National Endowment for the Humanities. T.R. Reid will take questions after his talk. If you would make your way to one of the two microphones, please keep your question brief so we can hear from as many questioners as possible. Afterwards, Mr. Reid will sign copies of his book in the Jayhawk Room, which is on this level, where there will also be a reception and all are welcome. If you're interested in following up tonight's event, a number of KU faculty will examine healthcare systems internationally in a panel discussion co-sponsored by International Programs and the Center for Global and International Studies at 3:30 p.m. on Thursday, October the 29th, in the Alderson Auditorium on the fourth level of this building. A gentle reminder to check your cell phone is off or muted, please. To introduce tonight's speaker, I've asked Alan Hansen, Professor of Anthropology, who first recommended tonight's speaker to us. Alan's two career-long interests have been first French Polynesia, where he did early field work, and the New Zealand Maori, and secondly, the social impact of technology. His most recent 2007 book was entitled The Trouble with Culture, How Computers Are Calming the Culture Wars. Alan is also a well-known activist on behalf of civil liberties and the peace movement. He's an active member of the ACLU, and for many years he was coordinator of the Lawrence Coalition for Peace and Justice. So please welcome Professor Alan Hansen.
One could not imagine a more timely topic than the subject of T.R. Reid's talk this evening. Several bills to reform the American healthcare system are currently staggering through Congress. Highlighted by the harsh glare of the media, they have been assaulted by every imaginable form of obstructionism, from town meetings that have degenerated into shouting matches, to dire warnings about death panels that will do in grandma, and that specter of the worst of all possible evils, socialized medicine. At this moment, we need a little common sense and sober reflection, and that is precisely what T.R. Reid has provided in his new book, The Healing of America, A Global Quest for Better, Cheaper, and Fairer Healthcare. Many people enter the debate about healthcare steeped in the fixed idea of American exceptionalism. America is indeed exceptional in many ways for which we may be justly proud. These include our long-standing and stable democratic form of government, our technological and commercial ingenuity, our system of higher education, and our contributions to human knowledge. But American exceptionalism has a less attractive side. That is a disinterest, even in some quarters a disdain, for what happens in other countries. We're Americans. We're number one. What can we possibly learn from them? Not only in his most recent book, but throughout his career as an author, journalist, public radio commentator, and television documentary host, T.R. Reid has refuted these smug elements of American exceptionalism. Perhaps an early contributing factor was his degree in classics from Princeton University, where he learned to appreciate civilizations which, while containing the seeds of our own, were nonetheless very different from it. Extended periods of residence abroad as chief of the Washington Post bureaus in Tokyo and London sharpened his interest and deepened his understanding of other countries and other cultures. His book, Confucius lives next door. What living in the East teaches us about living in the West describes, among other things, how Asians manage to live together in remarkably harmonious societies. While based in London, he gained a healthy respect for the achievements, growing affluence, and power of post-World War II Europe, which he details in his 2004 book, The United States of Europe, The New Superpower and the End of American Supremacy. These titles alone make obvious his view that other cultures can teach us valuable lessons and that important developments are taking place elsewhere in the world that we ignore to our detriment and, indeed, our peril. His most recent project, resulting in the book On the Healing of America, has been to travel to Canada, several countries in Europe, Japan, and Taiwan to study their healthcare systems and consider what we might learn from them. Tonight, he will take us with him on that journey, and I guarantee it will be a pleasurable one, for as well as eye-opening insights, he has the gift of conveying them with a very easy listening manner, as you will see. Along the way of this journey, he will doubtless dispel some of the unfortunate elements of American exceptionalism with the rousing cry, "We're number 37. Please join me in welcoming T.R. Reid.
See, I'm pretty high tech. I was able to make that work. Hi, everybody. What a beautiful day to be in Kansas, boy. I mean, the leaves are really at the peak. I do have to apologize about the rotten wet weather, and I apologize because I brought them with me. I live in Colorado, and yesterday it snowed all day in Colorado. When I woke up this morning, the sun was out, but I followed our rotten weather to Kansas, or maybe I brought it here. So I apologize. And speaking of Colorado, anybody watch the game last Saturday? We all did. Now, I had dinner with five very bright KU undergraduates, and they said, whatever you do, don't talk about that football game. So don't worry, my lips are sealed. I'll barely mention it. I like Kansas. As a reporter, I like Kansas. I was the Rocky Mountain bureau chief of the Washington Post twice in my life. And I say Rocky Mountain bureau chief. The fact is, I was the entire Rocky Mountain bureau of the Washington Post. You know, you're looking at it right here. I swept up, I answered the phone, but I called myself bureau chief. Don't you think that seems fair? And I would come over here now and then. I got some wonderful stories in Kansas. Once I went to Goodland, Kansas, probably as Republican and anti-communist a county as there is in the whole of the United States, and I sat around the morning breakfast cafe over coffee with a bunch of wheat farmers, and every one of them had been to Cuba to meet with Fidel Castro because he's buying Kansas wheat. I love that story. That was such an eye-opener. I came to KU once and did a story on a linguist who was trying to save Kansas's Native American languages. And the one that really caught my eye was he was trying to save the language of Kickapoo, of which there were about eight speakers at the time, and I think this guy did it. And then I spent a good deal of time covering and writing about Kansas's greatest inventor. Now, do you know who that would be? Kansas's greatest inventor? I don't know if you know this, but a fellow from Great Bend, Kansas, changed the daily life of the world. Jack S. Kilby, he invented the microchip. Invented the microchip. Before Jack, there were no cell phones, no computers, no calculators, no digital cameras, no rockets going to the moon, and Jack Kilby, this graduate of Great Bend High, invented the microchip. I got quite friendly with him. I wrote a book about Jack. He's a wonderful, wonderful guy. And in the year 2000, Jack won the Nobel Prize in Physics. And I went to Stockholm with Jack and his family to get that prize. It was great. And then the people of Great Bend, Kansas are very proud of this guy, you can imagine. He's probably the most distinguished graduate in the history of Great Bend High. He's their only Nobel Prize winner in physics, I guarantee you that. And so the school board in Great Bend got the idea, after Jack won the Nobel Prize, they're going to change the name of the high school to Jack S. Kilby High School. And they voted unanimously to do this, and they commissioned the big sign for the front of the school. And in comes this letter from Jack Kilby saying, that is the craziest idea I ever heard of. When they play Dodge City, they got to be Great Bend. They can't be Kilby. So I thought that was so Kansan that Jack wouldn't put up with that. Just a wonderful guy. So I've had some great stories as a reporter in Kansas. And then another reason I'm delighted to be here and delighted to see so many people turn out on a chilly night is to talk about, because I'm talking about healthcare, and maybe this is the fall when we're finally going to do something about our rotten healthcare system. Maybe. Which, as you all know, I'm sure you know, is the most expensive and the most unfair healthcare system of all the healthcare systems in any rich country. Some Americans get the world's greatest care in the world's finest facilities with no waiting, but the problem with our system, we leave tens of millions of our fellow citizens outside that door. About 20,000 Americans die every year, according to the National Academy of Sciences, of treatable diseases because they can't afford a doctor. And these are not the poorest of our neighbors. These tend to be people with a chronic disease. They lose their job, and therefore they lose their health insurance. If you have a chronic disease, you can't get insured in our country. These people are too rich for Medicaid and too poor to pay for the doctors and hospitals and drugs they need to stay alive. And in the richest country in the world, 20,000 a year die. Why would we let that happen? No other country lets that happen. And even if you have insurance or you can get care, if you can avoid physical calamity in America, if you get sick, you face fiscal calamity. In fact, some huge number of Americans goes bankrupt every year because of medical bills. That doesn't happen in any other rich country either. How many? This is a point of some dispute. It's a big, disturbing number. The key study on this field on medical bankruptcies was done at the Harvard School of Public Health. And they say that about 700,000 Americans go bankrupt every year because of medical bills. Just lose everything, they say, because they happen to get hit by a car or get sick. Why do we let that happen? Now, I'm a journalist, and you know, journalists, we read studies. I read this study very carefully, and you know what? It's a little hyped. I mean, they had to stretch to get to that number of 700,000. I'm sure the number is large and appalling, but I think, I'm not sure it's 700,000. But a little while ago, I was giving a speech to a group of physicians, and I said to them, you know, it was 20,000 Americans die of treatable diseases, 700,000 of us go bankrupt, although I think maybe that 700,000 is kind of a hokey number. And a woman in the audience raises her hand. I'm Dr. Steffi Woolhandler of the Harvard School of Public Health. And I wrote that study, she says. So let's agree at 700,000 just to... I think we can fix the system, and I'm confident we can. And the reason I know that is because all the other countries like us, and I mean by that advanced, high-tech, industrialized, free-market democracies, all of them, provide health care for everybody of high quality, and guess what? They spend half as much as we do on health care in the process. We could do that too. Hey, as I often say, if Taiwan can cover everybody, the United States of America can do it too. I'm sure we could. And so I went around the world for this book that Dr. Hansen mentioned to figure out how they do it. How do they cover everybody and spend less than we do? And here's what I'm going to do tonight. I am going to very quickly run down with you what I found when I went around the world. And then I'll try to shut up and leave time for your questions, which are probably a lot more interesting than my speech, would be my bet. And look, I'm a reporter. I'm going to try to be honest. I'll tell you what's good in these other countries. I'll tell you what's bad. And since we're being honest here, I'm going to tell you right up front that I have a hidden agenda. Here's my secret goal. Not so secret, because I'm going to tell you. So what my hope is I'm going to tell you this stuff very quickly, and I hope you'll say, boy, that was really interesting. I wonder if there's a book out there I could buy on this topic. Okay, so I'm going to tell you what I found when I went around the world, but first, I'll tell you what I didn't find, which in a way, maybe is just as interesting for Americans. You ready? In the first place, it's not all socialized medicine overseas. In fact, a lot of rich countries, Germany, France, Netherlands, Belgium, Switzerland, Japan, cover everybody with private docs, private hospitals, and private insurance companies. Not socialized medicine. In fact, in about 5 minutes, I'm going to argue to you that a lot of countries are less socialized than the United States. Second, it doesn't have to be single payer. Some countries have government-run single-payer plans, and they work. It would work here. But it doesn't have to be that. Japan, fantastic health results. Healthiest population in the world. They spend half as much as we do on health care and cover everybody. 3,000 different payers. Germany has 220 payers. Switzerland has 70. Doesn't have to be single-payer. And here's another important point. Guess what? They're not all the same. You leave the shores of the United States, and every country's healthcare system, in fact, they all differ because every country's healthcare system reflects the culture and the traditions and the history and the moral values of that nation. This is absolutely clear. So all the rich countries kind of face the same kind of difficult questions and problems we do. All rich countries have aging populations, which are harder to keep healthy. They all face this kind of quandary, paradox. The fantastic high-tech innovations are coming in medicine that definitely extend lives and reduce suffering. But guess what? They're really expensive. And all the systems are struggling with how to pay for modern medicine and deciding what to cover. So they all face the same questions. And here's the interesting thing. All the different countries I went to, they face the same decisions, and they come up with different answers. It varies country to country, depending on, you know, that country's culture and what the question is. For example, I'll give you an example. In my book, I talk about which countries, as part of their basic drug list, as their approved formulary, which ones cover Viagra. Kind of interesting question, because if it's on the approved list, then that drug is free or very cheap, $2 a month or something. And if it's not on the approved list, you can still buy it, but it costs a lot. So why would a country decide to cover Viagra as part of its? Why would that be considered basic health? And I went around the world and asked this, and it turns out, it's kind of interesting, in Britain, where they cover everybody in the National Health Service, I always thought of Britain, we lived in Britain and we used that service, it was good, but it's kind of stingy. There's a lot of stuff they won't cover. I mean, for example, when I lived in Britain, I used to go down the street to my family doctor, my GP, and I would say, hey, look, I'm a man of this age. I ought to be getting a blood test for prostate cancer, you know? No, we're not going to do that. And I'd say, no, in America, any man my age would automatically get this test for prostate cancer every year. Well, no, we're not going to do that because the National Health Service, we don't think it's cost effective. So I'm thinking, hey, if it finds cancer in my body, it's pretty damn cost effective. I want this test. But no, they don't do it because they're thinking of an entire population. There's just a lot of stuff. It's good health care, but there's a lot of stuff they've decided not to cover. But for some reason, the British official formulary does include Viagra. Why would that be? And I know what you're thinking, but you're wrong. No, the reason is a British scientist invented Viagra. Yes, and they're proud of this guy, so they're going to put his pill on their list. In fact, they're so proud of him. His name is Richard Stennis. His name is now Sir Richard Stennis because 2 years ago the Queen knighted him for this great medical achievement. They cover it, but if you go 25 miles away across the channel, the French system's a good healthcare system, they don't include Viagra on their basic formulary, right? So I'm in the health ministry in Paris, and I'm a reporter. I'm going around the world. I had this checklist of questions I ask everybody. So I'm going down the questions, and why don't you include Viagra in your basic formulary? This woman says, "The French men, they do not need Viagra." So they're all different, and they all come up with different solutions. But fortunately for my publisher who paid for this around the world adventure, you don't have to go to all of the 190 countries in the world to find out how healthcare works, because fortunately, they fall into categories. There are certain basic models that different countries follow. How many models? Well, that, of course, nothing about this is simple. That's another point of dispute. Now, the great, great healthcare economist at Princeton, Uwe Reinhardt, a really serious, thoughtful guy, he has a matrix of 16 different models that are used in different countries. But I'm not going to subject you to that. Look, I'm a journalist. I try to make this stuff accessible. So I'm going to tell you four models. In my book, I reduce them all to four models around the world. And we'll go through them very quickly. And here's what I want you to think about as I tell you about these models. In each system, who pays for the health care and who provides the health care? You got it? Okay. So I'm going to start with the beverage model of healthcare, the beverage model. This is named for Lord William Beveridge, who was kind of a classic British type. He was landed gentry. He was born to a title. He was born to a huge fortune. And this happens every once in a while in Britain. And as soon as this rich, rich man got out of Oxford, he went down to the streets of East London and devoted his life to helping the poor. And there are people like this. And he became a famous, famous social reformer. He founded the London School of Economics along the way. Probably the most famous social reformer in Britain in the first half of the 20th century. And towards the end of World War II, when it was clear that the U.S. and Britain were going to defeat the Nazis and Britain was going to emerge safe and whole out of World War II, Winston Churchill, the prime minister, decided that he'd better start thinking about what Britain would look like in the second half of the 20th century. What should a post-war Britain look like? And he hired the famous Lord Beveridge to do a study of British social services after the war. And Beveridge wrote this famous report, and the most important element of it is his plan for healthcare. And here's what he said. We're going to have a national health service, the NHS, and in this system, healthcare is government's job. It's a government function, just like putting out fires or running parks or running the public library. Healthcare is a service. When you need it, you go get it, and you don't get a bill. It's paid for through general taxation in the Beveridge model. And in the countries that have this model, Britain, France, Italy, New Zealand, most of Scandinavia, people go their entire lives and never get a doctor bill. In Britain, 98% of the people will live their entire life and never see a hospital bill. No bill, no copay, no deductible, no premium, no nothing. That's the Beveridge model. In the Beveridge model, government owns the hospitals. Government employs not all, but a lot of the doctors and most of the nurses. Government owns the scanning machines. And of course, as I said, government pays the bill. There are no bills. The Beveridge model of healthcare. My family lived in this, five Americans, we lived in London, and the NHS worked great for us. They have had problems with the waiting lists. The big problem is they don't spend any money on physical plants, so you go in the hospital and their bucket's catching the leaking rain. I mean, it's really pretty grody, but the care is fine. So I thought this system worked great for my family. Britain has had problems with waiting lists. They spent a lot of money to fix that. But still, you may have to wait in Britain, but you never get a bill. That's the Beveridge model of healthcare. Government's the provider of care. Government is the payer. And if government pays for the care and provides the care, I think I'd call that socialized medicine, wouldn't you? I mean, as we've heard, nobody really knows what socialized medicine means, but that's about as close as you're going to get, I think. That seems to me to be socialized medicine. And it works. It worked fine for my family. Now, we're going to jump across to the mainland of Europe and find the next model, which is the mirror image of the beverage model. The second model is the Bismarck model of healthcare. It's called that because it was started by Otto von Bismarck, who was the first chancellor of Germany. He's a Prussian who united about 25 different German-speaking fiefdoms and principalities into a country called Germany in 1871. And anybody been to the Central Park in Berlin, the Tiergarten? And there's this massive 10-foot statue of their first chancellor, Bismarck. I mean, it's big because not only was he the first chancellor of Germany, he was the fattest chancellor of Germany. And you can see that in that statue. But in this statue, he's a Prussian general. You know, he's got this 8-foot-long Prussian sword. He has a spiked helmet on his head. He looks ferocious. You wouldn't think of this guy as a warm and fuzzy kind of guy. But in fact, Bismarck invented the welfare state. He was looking for ways to convince all these Alsatians and Hanoverians and Bavarians that they really belonged to a new country called Germany. And so he started giving benefits from the central government in Berlin. First of all, in 1873, he invented the old age pension paid for by government. We would call that Social Security. We got around to it in 1935. In 1876, he invented workman's compensation. If you got hurt on the job, no problem, the government would pay to take care of your injury. And in 1883, he created the world's first national health care system, where government found a mechanism, a system, to make sure that everybody had health insurance. But it's not a government insurance plan. In the Bismarck model, everybody has to buy insurance, but you buy it from private insurance companies. And you split the premium between the worker and the employer. Does that sound strange to Americans? 155 million Americans are on the Bismarck model to this day. It's used all over the world. It's used in Germany, of course, France, Belgium, Switzerland, Netherlands, Japan, etc. And in this system, as I said, the insurance plans are private. The doctors are private. The hospitals are private. The drug companies are private. This is universal coverage, but it's not socialized medicine. In fact, many of these countries, Germany, Switzerland, Belgium, Netherlands, they don't have Medicare for seniors. People just stay with the private system, cradle to grave. They don't have Medicaid for poor people because everybody's in the private system. To me, less socialized than the United States. That's the Bismarck model of healthcare. It works fine. It works great around the world. My third model, I call it the national health insurance model. This is a blend of the two. In the national health insurance model, the providers, the docs, the hospitals, the labs, are private, often for profit. But the payment system is government. And this system was invented in Canada. Canada's the paradigm case. Everybody pays taxes to a government insurance plan, and you go to the doctor for free. And the government pays the doctor. This was invented in 1944 in Canada by a guy named Tommy Douglas, who was the premier, that's the governor, of one province. And when he came up with this system, he gave it a name. You know what he called it? Medicare. He called it Medicare. And in 1965, when Lyndon Johnson extended health insurance to all American seniors, he took the model, that is private treatment but public payment, and the name Medicare from Canada. That's a Canadian model of health care. So 44 million Americans are on that model, the national health insurance model. It's used in Canada, South Korea, Taiwan, Australia. And it works pretty well. In my book, I'm really tough on Canada. The title of my chapter on Canada is Sorry to Keep You Waiting, because the doctor I spent time with in Canada told me he says sorry to keep you waiting so often, he's going to put it on his gravestone so he never has to say it again. Here's the deal in Canada. Look, if you're sick, if you're acutely ill and you need treatment, they'll treat you fast and free. I mean, they'll send an ambulance to your house for free. You go to the hospital for free. The follow-up care is free. That part's good. If what you have is your back hurts, or your knee hurts, or you need a new hip, or you have a bum shoulder like I do that only goes this high, then you wait. And the Canadians have done that on purpose. They've limited the number of specialists and operating rooms and scanning machines just to save money. And here's what happened. When I was in Canada, as I said, I spent a week with this wonderful doctor, and people from every ilk of life, I mean, other doctors, lawyers come into his office and get treated for free, and smelly, filthy people come in off the street with no money or anything, and they get treated for free because it's Canada, that's what they do. But, as I say, if what you need can be put off, they'll put it off. So I say to this doctor, look, doc, my shoulder only goes this high, it's pretty stiff, and it hurts every morning when I wake up. What are you going to do? And he says, well, I'll send a letter to an orthopedic surgeon to get you an appointment. You need to see an orthopedic surgeon. Yeah, fine, that's good. How long will it take? 10 or 12 months. 12 months. 12 months, I say. Wait a minute, my shoulder hurts every morning when I wake up. I don't want to wait 12 months to get treated. And he says, oh, I didn't say treated. No, it'll be 12 months for the first consultation. It'll be months after that if he wants to do anything. This is a decision that Canadians have made to save money, but it's not a function of the model. The national health insurance model in many countries, according to comparative studies, has shorter waiting times for an appointment, shorter waiting times for surgery than the United States does. So it's not a function of the model, but Canada is really plagued by this system. So I'm in the health ministry in Ottawa, right? And the guy in the health ministry says to me, you know, we're Canadians, and we're kind of laid back. We're kind of understated people. We don't go around chanting, we're number one, like some people I know, you know. You know, like everybody from Colorado was chanting in the stadium the other day. But he says, I do need to point out that there are two areas where we're better than your United States, hockey and healthcare. And I say, well, okay, you treat people, but come on, how what are you bragging about? I mean, I got this bum shoulder here, it would take me 12 months just to see the doctor. How can you brag about that? And this guy says, yeah, you're right, that's an issue. We've made some bad decisions, and we need to improve, shorten the waiting lists in our country. But let me tell you this, something you need to know about Canadians. He said, you know, Canadians don't mind waiting that much for elective surgery, as long as the rich Canadian and the poor Canadian have to wait about the same amount of time. Now, right there in that sentence, there's a national ethic of healthcare. And it's not our ethic. So I've given you three models, right? Those are the three models found in wealthy countries. The fourth model I'm going to give you is the most common model in the world, because in about 150 of the world's 200 countries, they don't have money for a healthcare system. Just providing food and shelter is tough enough. Healthcare is a luxury. And so in the third world countries, the developing countries, the healthcare model everywhere is what's called the out-of-pocket model. Just what it says. If your child is sick and you got some money in your pocket to pay a doctor, she'll be treated. If you don't have the money to pay the doctor, she stays sick or she dies. Brutal, simple fact of life for most people in the world. You don't have to pay in money. People pay with whatever they've got. You pay with potatoes. People weave a rug for the doctor's office. In some countries, the mother brings her sick child in and will wet nurse the doctor's baby to pay for her care, whatever you've got. I went to a clinic in Nepal, way up north of Kathmandu, up by Everest, where there are no roads, you walk everywhere. And I walked about an hour and a half up a steep hill, And on top of this hill is the medical clinic, the plainest little squattest building you'd ever seen. You could mistake it for an outhouse, just a plain, square, stucco building, except all the walls were a different color. So I'm inside talking to the doctor, and doctor, do your patients pay you? He says, yeah, I mean, some guys, they have, some guy just, you know, sold his yak on the market. He has some money to pay me. He said, a lot of people don't have money. He says, I eat a lot of potato soup. And that chair over there, somebody built a chair for behind his desk and carried it up on his back and gave it to the doctor to pay. And he said, a lot of people say to me, gee, doctor, I'm sorry I can't pay you, but I have some paint at home. I'll paint your clinic. And they all have a different color. And that's what you see. So that is the most common model in the world, the out-of-pocket model. So I've given you four, right? The beverage model, Bismarck, National Health Insurance, and the out-of-pocket model. And as I said, I spent 3 years going around the world studying these models of healthcare. And we don't want to tell my publisher this, but I didn't really have to do that. Here's the secret. You can find all four models right here in the United States. We've got them all. If you happen to be a Native American or a veteran, well then, for healthcare, you live in Britain. Veterans go to government hospitals, they're treated by government doctors and government nurses, government buys the pills, and the patient gets no bill. That's the beverage model of healthcare right here in the United States, extremely popular. Nobody would dare suggest that veterans switch to private insurance. They love that model. If you're over 65 and on Medicare, if you have government insurance paying private providers, you live in Canada. That's the Canadian model. That's where we got the model. That's national health insurance. The difference is, in the other national health insurance models, Canada, Australia, et cetera, everybody's covered. The United States only provides it for people over 65. And if you're a working person and you're splitting the cost of a private insurance plan with your employer, well, you live in Germany. That's the Bismarck model of healthcare. And as I said, about 150 to 155 million Americans run it. Last year it was 155 million, but lots of employers have dropped insurance in the last year or so, or people have lost their jobs. Probably 150 million Americans are on it. And if you're one of the 47 or so million Americans on any given day who have no health insurance, well, you live in Afghanistan. You live in Angola, Algeria, for healthcare purposes. If you can come up with the money to pay a doctor, or if you can line up in a big city at the public hospital, you get treated. Otherwise, tough. That's the out-of-pocket model right here in the richest country in the world. We've got them all. And here's the big difference. Here's the fundamental difference between the United States and all the other countries in the world. In all the other countries, they've decided that everybody should be in the same system. You know, maybe they like big government. Maybe they have a beverage model of socialized medicine. Everybody's in it. Or maybe it's Germany or Japan or Switzerland, capitalist private sector countries with a Bismarck model, but everybody's in the same system. Some countries have a medical, military medical corps, so if a soldier's overseas, you get shot or you get sick, a military doctor treats you. But you know what? As soon as that British lieutenant goes home from Afghanistan, she's in the NHS with everybody else. One model for everybody. Now, during our 2008 presidential campaign, there was a lot of discussion about foreign healthcare systems. The Brits were really ticked off at us for saying their system didn't work. It works pretty well. But one thing that you heard a lot, particularly John McCain said this all the time, he says, well, we don't want to copy those foreign countries because they have one-size-fits-all medicine. They put everybody in the same system. Why would you want to do that? Why would you want to have one-size-fits-all medicine? Well, you know, I went around the world and I asked health ministers in every country, Why would you do that? Why would you do that? And I'll tell you their answers, and you can decide for yourself whether this makes sense to you. Okay? So why would you want everybody to be in the same system? Well, for one thing, if there's one set of rules and one set of forms and one set of prices for everybody, it's vastly simpler. and it's vastly cheaper. In fact, many economists say that it's our crazy quilt system of overlapping and competing systems that that make us the most expensive system in the world. I went to the biggest hospital in Canada, 1,600 beds. I mean, even in America, that's a big hospital. And the president's taken me around. He's very proud. Here's our new birthing facility. You know, here's our scan. We're very proud of it, you know. And I say to this guy, well, where's the billing office? And he gets all embarrassed, you know. The billing office. Well, the billing office in a 1,600-bed hospital in America, it would be 150 people. In Canada, the billing office is two part-timers who come in the last 2 days of the month. That's it. And one of them, her full-time job is to send bills to American tourists who are in town and broke their leg. And he says to me, your insurance companies never pay, you know. Vastly simpler. And the difference you can see in administrative costs. Now, the American private insurance companies, these are for-profit, competitive, free enterprise companies, exactly the approach that we often think is the best way to provide any good or service. Competitive, free market, free enterprise companies, right? As a matter of fact, the American private insurance industry is the least efficient, most wasteful payer in the world. I'm not making this up. This is statistical. Our private insurance companies have administrative costs. They report this to the federal government every quarter, range between 18 and 25, 26%. That is, they add 20% to every doctor bill they pay. Is that necessary? Well, let's look at other countries. France, 61 million people, 14 insurance companies, and their administrative costs are 4.5%. Anybody here think of France as a model of management efficiency? But yet, the Harvard and Stanford MBAs who are running our insurance companies waste four times as much money on paperwork as the French do. Germany, 5%. Japan, 5.5%. No other country has as much administrative cost built into the system as we do because they cover everybody in one system. It's just simpler. Okay, the next reason you want everybody in one system is because it gives you an economic incentive to provide preventive medicine, what you might call public health. Public health, preventive medicine, there's some dispute about which procedures help and which don't, but it definitely keeps people healthy, and it definitely extends human life, and it saves money for a healthcare system over the years. But guess what? You got to spend money to do preventive medicine, and you may not see the return for 20 or 25 years. So if you think about an American insurance company, the average insurance customer in America is with her insurance company about 4.8 years. And then she moves to a new job or her husband gets covered or something. So for that insurance company, remember, it has to pay a dividend to investors every quarter. It's stupid. It's a waste of their money to keep you healthy. By the time you get sick, you're the next guy's problem. A lot of the diseases they might prevent aren't even going to show up till you're 68, and then you're Medicare's problem. You see, there's no economic incentive. But the other countries where everybody's in, cradle to grave, they really have an incentive to keep you healthy. You with me on this? You go to Britain, for example. I say in my book they have the best preventive medicine in the world. I mean, they have this TV ad in Britain, and mom is cooking supper in a big pot, you know, it's a big pot on the range. And you can just see it's one of those disgusting British dinners like porridge, you know, or Marmite or something like that, you know. And the kids say, Mum, when's supper? When's supper? And Mum says, just a sec, Dolly. Almost. And then the announcer says, is Mum coughing a lot? Call this 800 number. We'll send a nurse over free to check for bronchitis. And we won't tell Mum who called, it says. Like that. There are big signs in Britain, big posters. Do your feet hurt? Call this 800 number. We'll send a podiatrist over for free. You know why? Because foot pain can be an incipient indicator of some pretty serious diseases. They want to get it early. they have an interest in that, and that's another reason you want everybody in. Now, the kind of irony here is a lot of the most important advances in preventive medicine are American technology. We are great at this. But as I say in my book, I think the other countries have done a better job of putting our ideas into practice. Jeff, let's get the display up here. So, for example, it was the United States, an American doctor, who figured out in 1953 that smoking causes lung cancer. This is a really shocking notion. In 1953, there were ads on the radio, 3 out of 4 doctors recommend Luckies. You know, it was good for you. And this American doctor over at Washington University in St. Louis proved that smoking causes lung cancer, and people started campaigning. It took 13 years, but in 1966, we invented the Surgeon General's warning on a pack of cigarettes. This has been a great boon, and you can see this. I just want you to take a look at this. The front and the back of the pack say Marlboro, or Lucky's taste great, right? But on the side of the pack, there is a warning. That one says Surgeon General's warning, cigarette smoking contains carbon monoxide. I guess that's bad, huh? Now, 100 countries around the world now require tobacco warnings. They learned this from us. But guess what? They do it a little differently. In fact, this warning here is kind of a powder puff compared to, let's see if I can get the British one up there. And the rule is, it has to be on the front and back of the pack in black letters on a white background. That's the law. And when Marlboro buys a billboard or buys an ad in a magazine in Britain, the word smoking kills have to be larger than any other word in the ad. And this has been, yeah. This has been so effective that all EU countries now use it. Let's see, here's another one. Couvertue, that's French. Smoking kills you. In Italy, il fumo uccide. That sounds bad. In Portugal, fumar mata. In German, now the German one, my mother was German, and when she got mad at us, she would sort of relapse into German, so it's a scary language for me anyway. But in German, the warning is rauchen ist tödlich. Rauchen ist tödlich. Smoking is deadly, right? And then, for some reason that I haven't figured out yet, I should know this, I'm a reporter. If you go to the other German-speaking country, Austria, it's slightly different. In Austria, the warning is, Rauchen kann tödlich sein. Rauchen kann tödlich sein. Smoking can be deadly. You got a shot, right? So, so my kind of mindset is, there's some German trucker, and he's carrying a load from Munich, Germany, down south across the River Salz to Salzburg, Austria, right? And he's smoking along the way. Well, as long as he's in Germany, he's a dead man driving, right? But if he can just get into Austria, maybe, you know, he's okay. All right, now here's another. I love this one. Here's another. This is Romanian. Smokers die young. And you end up in the morgue, obviously, is the rule here. Now, in my view, the world champion at tobacco warnings, only a reporter would do this kind of study, but I've done the study, and the world champion of tobacco warnings is Canada. They really have good warnings. For one thing, they put these disgusting anatomical pictures on the cigarette pack of what happens to your body if you smoke. Like, for example, that's your heart. They show damaged lungs. They have this one where some poor guy is smiling and all his teeth are brown and falling out, you know, because he smoked. Pretty disgusting. And last year, I was in Canada, and I was in the health ministry with that friendly guy I told you about. And he said to me, hey, have you seen my new warning? Really, it's phenomenal. I said, well, you already have the best warnings in the world. He says, no, this one takes the cake. This is the best. All righty, so are you ready for this? Here it is. Best tobacco warning in the world. In Canada, they call this the limp penis picture. That's the official name. And so sure enough, so this guy, so I, you know, leave the health ministry and I go down to a 7-Eleven or something to buy a pack of cigarettes. They cost like $9 in Canada, you know. And I go into the store and there's this 18-year-old kid as the clerk. And I say, I need a pack of cigarettes. What brand? I say, I don't care about the brand. I just want that good warning, you know. So the kid is looking through, you know, and he says, oh, God, I didn't know that, you know. And he sells me the cigarettes. That'll be $8.89. And I say to this kid, 19 years old or something, I say, you know, I don't really want the cigarettes. I just want the pack. And he says, I'll take them. So that's all, Jeff. We're done. So that's, you know, these things work. And I think they've saved millions and millions of lives and billions of dollars, but they don't always work. So that's my second reason why you want one-size-fits-all medicine. Are you with me? Gives you an economic incentive to keep people healthy. Here's what the British, I said to the health minister in Britain when I lived there, his name was John Reid. I liked him a lot. And I said to him one day, you know, I really like living in your country. You have all those posters and TV ads. It just makes me feel like a lot of smart people are working hard to keep me healthy. And I like that feeling. And he says to me, isn't it obvious? Isn't it obvious? I'm not doing that because I like you. He says, no, no. He says, there's a reason I have to do that. He says, look, in our system, in the NHS, everybody's in. Nobody pays. So from the minute the line turns blue on your mother's pregnancy test until the minute you flatline in my hospital 90 years later, you're my patient. Of course I want to keep you healthy. You see, that's an economic incentive for preventive care, which we don't have because of our convoluted system. And now, the third reason why you want everybody to be covered in one system, and they all agree on this, they think it's fairer. They think it's fairer. They think it's fairer if everybody has the same access to the same care at the same price. They think it's fairer. And now, you know, I make an admission here. I've now, the speech of mine has taken a turn because I really have been trying to be an objective reporter. I think my book is fairly objective. I really look at the good and bad of these countries. But once you start talking about fair or just or decent or ethical or humane or moral, once you're into those terms, that's not objective reporting anymore because morality, those are subjective judgments. And you know what? The major lesson I learned going around the world is that healthcare is a moral issue. The design of any country's healthcare system. The design of any country's healthcare system, obviously it involves medical decisions, it involves political decisions, we're learning that. It involves economic decisions, but fundamentally, to design a country's healthcare system, you've got to know that country's fundamental moral values. So if your country believes, as that guy in Canada said to me, if you believe that healthcare is a common good and that everybody in your country who needs access to a doctor can have it, if you make that moral commitment, well, then you can design a system like the ones I saw in Canada, Britain, Germany, Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, Switzerland, where everybody's covered. And if you don't make that fundamental moral commitment at the start, or if you never even have the conversation, as I think the United States has never had, well, then you end up maybe with a healthcare system where some people get the finest care in the finest facilities in the world with no waiting, and tens of millions of others in the same country get little or none. That is, if you don't make the initial moral commitment, you end up with the American healthcare system. And that's it. That's the lesson of my book. I'll tell you why authors need editors. I spent years on this book, as I said. It was much harder than I thought. I sent in the whole book. In chapter 11, I lay out in great, and I thought to me, fascinating detail, this whole moral question. Is healthcare a right or is it an economic commodity? Is there a legal right to healthcare? Can you provide a right to health or only to health care? All those questions. Why do other countries do it? What's the religious impulse that leads us to care for the least of our brethren? And how come church going in the United States has never done this? Are you with me on this? Chapter 11. And my editor calls me up and says, well, I got the book finally, and thank you very much, but could I just ask you one question? How come you saved the most important point of the whole book for chapter 11? This is why authors need editors, you know. And I said, I always knew I was going to get to it. If you take a look at my book, I now hit the moral issue on the first page. On the first page, because that's where it belongs. That's the real question here. And so here's what I'm going to do. I am not going to give you a pass on buying my book. You still have to buy my book. But, and Christmas is coming, as you know. But I'm going to summarize my book in one sentence. If we could find the will, if we could find the political will to provide health care for everybody in America, if we could find the will, the other rich countries can show us the way. Thank you. I would be very happy to take your questions, which are probably going to be a lot more interesting than my speech, would be my bet. Yes, sir.
You mentioned that we have four different kinds of health care systems in the United States. And you say, but you say the United States is 37th in outcomes, and I think is what your point is. But do the people in any of those four systems, even like the Bismarck model, does anybody, even if somebody that has private insurance and a lot of money, do they actually have better outcomes than they do in Sweden or Japan or something?
Yeah, he asked, did you hear that question? Do they have better outcomes? Yeah, that was a very disturbing part of my conclusion. I thought at least, I mean, even though our system is unfair, the quality must be great. I mean, nobody can do better health care than the United States. As it turns out, there are a lot of international comparative studies on this. The Commonwealth Fund in New York is kind of the gold standard of this. And they issue every year, they issue what they call a national report card on healthcare. They compare us to the 22 other richest countries in the world. They compare the top 23. In some areas, America's number one. Recovery rates, survival rates from breast cancer, we lead the world. We're the best in that. But many other cancers, diabetes, lupus, a lot of chronic diseases, we rate 20th or 21st in terms of survival rates compared to the other rich countries. There are a lot of areas where we do quite poorly, and I kind of hate to tell you this, but in terms of neonatal mortality, that is keeping newborn babies alive for the first year of their life, the United States of America ranks 23 out of the 23 richest countries. We're the worst. So even in terms of quality, we don't do well, and it's not because the Mayo Clinic is screwing up. People who go to Johns Hopkins or the Mayo Clinic, they do great. Some people in America get the world's best care. That's why Arab sheiks fly here. No, it's all the people we leave out who have little or no access is the reason that our overall health statistics rank pretty poorly compared to other rich countries.
Yes. As a leading-edge baby boomer, and there are 78 million behind me about to hit Medicare, I'm really concerned about cost containment. And the theme of your book was that you were seeing countries whose costs were rising, that they hadn't gotten a handle on that yet. Have you come to any other conclusions as to what they might be doing or what we might be doing to address the cost control issue?
Yeah. As I said, every country is facing problems with rising costs, but no, they all do a better job on it than we do. They spend half as much, or in some cases, Switzerland spends about 65% as much on health care as we do per capita. Britain spends half, Japan spends half, Canada spends a little less than half than we do. and gets pretty decent results. You know, they do just as well. No, they've done a better job on cost control. And I'm convinced of this. This is what I say in my book. I think it's right. The key issue to get cost control is to get everybody covered. Now, does that seem illogical? It might seem to you that the first thing to do is cut costs, and then you can afford to cover everybody. All the other countries did it the other way, as I said. All the other countries first decided, doggone it, we're going to cover everybody. And when you get everybody in the system, as I said, you have, A, the administrative savings, but B, you have the political will to make tough decisions on cost control that we don't have. We've learned that this summer. You need to have everybody covered, and then everybody has a stake in seeing costs controlled. Everywhere I went in the world, I said to people, what are we going to do to get our costs under control? They're rising four times the rate of inflation. Get everybody covered. That's the first step. And I think in our debate this summer, we've gone about it backwards. Washington has really hung up on cost control, which we know is politically difficult. But we're still going to leave 20, 25 million people out of the system. And you need to have everybody in. And then the doctor can't put up a sign saying no Medicare accepted because everybody's in the system or in some system. And you have the political will to make tough choices. So that, it can be done. Look, Japan, amazing country, the oldest population in the world and the healthiest population in the world. Those two shouldn't go together. And yet, the Japanese love going to the doctor. It's just a cultural thing to do. They go to the doctor on average 15 times a year. We go 4.8. They have three times as many MRI scans, twice as many x-rays per capita. They use twice as many prescription drugs per capita as we do. When a woman has a baby in Japan, mother and child stay in the hospital 10 days after the birth, on average. And Japan spends $3,400 a year per capita on health care, and we spend $7,400, more than twice. It can be done. You can get cost control, but you got to get everybody in the system to do it. That's the argument on my book. Yes, sir.
You mentioned the controls on the administrative costs of health insurance companies. I heard you on the radio the other day. What other kinds of ways do the countries which use private insurance companies control the behaviors, the pay rates, et cetera, of these private insurance companies?
Yeah, that's a good question. I didn't want to take the time to go into it, but I'm glad you asked. So I said that universal coverage can work in a system of private insurance companies. I've seen it happen. But they're not our kind of private insurance. In fact, no other country would let any company sell the product that is sold as health insurance in the United States. They wouldn't dream of it. In the other countries, here's the rules. The insurers have to cover everybody. No pre-existing condition. And the corollary of that is everybody has to buy insurance. Those two go together. It's like the law of gravity. We're now having a debate as to whether we want to do that, but every country has agreed on that. Two and two are four, and you need everybody to buy insurance so that the companies can cover everybody. You with me this far? Next, you got to pay every claim. They can't deny any claims. Any claim certified by a hospital, a doctor, a chiropractor, a lab, they have to pay. In most cases, they have to pay them very quickly. In France, the insurance company has to pay the doctor within 3 days. Now, any doctor here get paid within 3 days? In Switzerland, the regulations vary by canton, by state. But in a lot of Switzerland, if the insurance company doesn't pay your health insurance claim in 5 days, next month's premium is free. Now, that's good health insurance. They can't put on a lifetime limit like our insurers do. They can't cut you off once you get sick. And as long as you continue to pay your premium, they have to renew you. What I'm saying is, and they have, as I said, they have strict limits on administrative costs. Private health insurance can work, but the government has to regulate it to make it work. When they do, it works fine. Yeah.
I get the feeling you're talking to the choir here. Have you had any luck trying to talk to the people in Washington who can actually do something about it?
Yeah, have I talked to the people in Washington? You know, an author should not be greedy. My book, this new book of mine, has just gotten great reviews. That's not always true of my books, but this one has gotten great reviews. It hit the New York Times bestseller list the first week, and it's been there for weeks. What more can you ask for? So I'm greedy. So I want good reviews and good sales, and I want to have some policy impact. I want my book to make a difference in our debate. And I have to say, in fact, I told the senators this, nobody who read my book would have written the Baucus bill. You know, it just wouldn't have come out. I mean, this is a bill that leaves 20 million Americans uninsured 5 years from now. No other country would do that. So far, no, I have been to Washington, and I presented my film based on this book to the Senate Finance Committee. And I was just at the Brookings Institution 2 weeks ago, and, you know, a bunch of members were there, and a couple of senators stood up and said, "Whoa, wonderful book, it's a great book." But they're not listening, you know. And so I've so far seen zero policy impact, and maybe I don't have the right to ask. Yeah.
Thanks for being here. To be honest, of the four models you described, none of them sound very good, from the tax rates in Sweden to the leaking roofs in the British hospitals to the 14-month waiting periods in Canada. It's not the outcome that I want. It's not the health care that I experience, and I think that a lot of people in America want to experience. Editorializing aside,
yeah,
and with all respect,
yeah,
which of the four outcomes that you described or models that you described is America most likely to see in the next 2, 5, maybe 10 years? Thank you.
Well, in the first place, you're right. All systems have problems. There's no question about that. And those beverage model systems where the government provides the care and pays for the care, they have high taxes. The sales tax on anything you buy in Britain is 17.5%. Get this. As part of their stimulus plan, they cut taxes and they cut the sales tax to 15% for 1 year. But you know, there are economists who study these things. And as a matter of fact, when you take into account the high income taxes they pay and the high property taxes they pay and that 17.5% sales tax, the Brit still comes out ahead because he's not paying $600 a month to insure his family. He never pays a deductible. He never pays a copay. I'm not making this up. I mean, there are data. There are charts you can see. In other countries, people pay less for health care than we do. Yeah, taxes are higher and health insurance rates are lower. So you come out ahead. I'll give you the choice. You can pay $200 a month in tax and $600 a month in health insurance taken out of your check, or you can have $500 taken out of your check as tax. Which would you choose? I mean, unless, you know, if you really despise the notion of taxation, that's fine. Then pay the higher fee for private insurance in America. But if the goal is to get everybody covered at a reasonable cost, those countries are doing a better job. It would be my answer to you. Yes.
This may be an unpopular question in light of Joe Wilson's recent outburst, but what kind of stipulations would we have for immigrants, legal or otherwise, since that is more of an issue in our country than in France, for instance?
Well, that's a good question. What do countries do about illegal immigrants? It's not only an American problem. Many, all the rich countries, in fact, have serious problems with illegal immigrants, and they all have sort of Tom Tancredo-like nationalist parties, you know, that say, put up a fence, kick them out, we don't want them. That's a pretty strong feeling, particularly in Europe. You know, in the EU, I wrote a book about this, as a matter of fact. In the EU, they don't have any borders anymore. If you get into any of the 27 countries, you can go to any of them and live there, and, you know, people take jobs illegally. And people are trying to kick them out, but that's a completely different issue from healthcare. If you're illegally in the country and you fall down and break your leg or you get the measles, they treat you. Now, it may be as soon as you leave the hospital, they'll try to kick you out of their country. But none of them has decided to restrict healthcare to their citizens. They treat everybody in the country. I'm not sure I agree with you that it's less of an issue in France. I mean, Spain is very, very upset about this. The Brits are just furious about illegal immigrants. It sounds like America when you turn on British TV. So a lot of countries have this issue, but they just haven't decided that healthcare is a place to enforce immigration laws.
Yeah. Hi. I'm with Medical Whistleblower, and we are a group that reports medical fraud, patient abuse and neglect, and human rights violations. And our members recently testified to the California Congress in regards to medical fraud and extensive diagnostics done for profit, sometimes unnecessarily. And we have had one doctor reported over 200 open heart bypass surgeries that were unnecessary that led to two deaths and an FBI investigation. We have found that medical fraud is more common here because we have such a piecemeal system of billing and insurance, and it is easier to hide fraud. And fraud is a hidden cost of our medical care system. Did you find any figures in regards to fraud in the other countries you saw?
Yeah, as it turns out, every country has doctors who are cheating. Every country has hospitals that overbill. Not Britain, because the hospitals are part of the government, but every country where you have to file a bill to some payer have people who cheat. That's common in every country, and they all try to police it as well as they can. The difference, I think, is in America, you know, insurance companies turn down your claim because they say, well, that's not a legitimate expense or something. In the other countries, they got to pay your claim. There's some other mechanism to go after the fraudulent doctor, but they don't do it by shafting the patient and not paying the claim. That's a big difference to me. Yeah.
Okay. I have lots of questions, so if you don't have an answer to this one, I have a backup question.
Yeah, okay.
What can we do? I think a lot of people want something to be done. I've heard on NPR that most people want a public option, but Congress is probably not likely to pass it. Do you have any recommendations on what we can do to get the Congress to do something?
Well, I think members of Congress do listen. And I think they listen. If you let them know you care, you're going to argue to me that they've been bought and sold by the insurance companies and the hospital companies. Yeah, I'm not there yet. I think they do listen, although this summer's debate doesn't make you confident, I have to say. I just think you have to keep calling them. You got to figure the insurance company sends somebody in to see your senator every day. So if somebody from Lawrence calls them every day or sends them a letter every day and says, please, let's crack down, let's have some serious regulation on the insurance industry like other countries do, I think they'll listen to that. That's my guess. I hope it's true.
I was wondering...
Can we just finish these off?
Yeah, I'm sure.
America's a lot bigger, bigger than most of the other countries you cited. I was curious if you saw any sort of structures for rural service delivery or anything like that in any of the systems that you describe in your book.
Yeah. Rural health care is a problem in every country. For some reason, those French docs would rather live in Paris than out in the country. Just like our docs want to go to Chicago. No, it's really true. It's a serious problem where I live in Colorado. I said Colorado, you remember the school you played last week? All countries have problems with it. I mean, it's a little easier. In some countries, well, I think we do this here, but the NHS in Britain pays you more if you go to Pembrokeshire than if you work in London, you know, kind of thing to encourage. So other countries... struggle with this too. Canada has very serious problems with this. In rural Canada, there are a lot of doctor's office where you go in the morning and you take a number, and then she does a lottery and picks the 20 people, 20 numbers she can see that day because they don't have enough docs. And countries bring in doctors from Nigeria, whatever they can do, try to speed up the training program. A very good way to deal with this issue is to have what do they call them, sub-doctor treatment, nurse assistants, physician's assistants, people with a little less training, who can do a lot, and put them in the rural clinic is a way. But every country that I went to is struggling with this. Yeah.
I think we only need three more questions, please. One here and the two over there who have been waiting for quite a while.
Okay.
I lived in Germany for 8 years, so
yes.
I'm pretty good familiar with the European systems. You showed us a snapshot of what it looks like around the world, but what is the trend? Every year I was in Germany, the care costs went up and the coverage went down, and I'm afraid if we try to model ourselves after that, we're overshooting. We're modeling a system that's already shown itself to be too much.
When were you there?
From 2000 to 2008.
Yeah. Certainly from 2000 to 2008, costs went up in Germany. There's no question about that. Guess what? They went up almost twice as much in the United States. So if the problem is access to care is reduced and costs are going up, we have that problem too. My argument is the other countries, because they have universal coverage and the cost controls that come with it, have done a better job of dealing with that issue, but it's certainly a problem in every country. Now, here's what happened in Germany. They decided in 2006, for the first time, because costs were so high, that they were going to charge a copay. Before that, they had never charged a copay. And the patients went, you know, German people went nuts. They went bananas. They hated this. So they negotiated, and they came up, here's the copay. This is still the copay in Germany. It's 10 euros, which is about, well, it's now $15. And you have to pay it once a quarter. And once you pay the copay once a quarter, you were there when they did that. Yeah. You don't pay for anything else. So I spent some time in my book and in the film, I spent some time with just a delightful doctor in Kladow, which is south of Berlin. And it's a charming town on a lake, and some American expats have settled there, right? And some of them are her patients. So she told me that this American came in January of 2006, you know, with the cold or measles or something. And she said, oh, Bruce, I'm really sorry to tell you, but from now on you have to pay me when you come in here. You have to pay me 10 euros. And the old Bruce's American, feel 14 bucks, sure, fine, here, you know, no problem. And guess what? So he had some other problem in mid-March. And he came back to her, and she says, he tried to pay me again. And this woman says to me, what happens in your country? Do you have to pay every time you go to the doctor? Like that. Yes, sir.
First of all, I'm a Great Bend High School graduate, so I appreciate the Jack Kilby plug.
Ah, great. Yes.
Mike,
so how would you have voted on changing the name?
Well, Great Bend's also the hometown of Skip Yao, who's the co-founder of JanSport. So,
he didn't get a Nobel Prize. But
no, he didn't.
It's something, yeah.
Maybe he should. My question is regarding the Bismarck system. From your description, it seems very similar to mandates we have here in the U.S. and most states that require automobile owners to have auto insurance. And this works fine because the people who can afford to buy cars can afford insurance. So I guess my question is, what do states like Germany do with the people who can't afford cars?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Here's the deal. In those Bismarck countries, it's sometimes people just buy the insurance out of their pocket, but quite often, generally, you split the cost with your employer. If you lose your job, you keep your insurance. And government takes the role of the employer and pays your employer's part of the premium. If you have so little money that you can't pay any of the premium, then government pays it for you, which is quite similar to what we're looking at in the Baucus bill. The crucial thing is everybody keeps their private insurance because of all the weird, strange twists and turns of American health policy, the cruelest one has to be that when you lose your job and you really need health insurance, we take it away from you. Who would have thought of that? No other country does it that way. In the other countries, if you lose your job, the government pays the employer's part until you get another job. Or if you can't afford it all, the government pays. But as I said, there's no Medicaid. There's no government-run health care program. You stay with private insurance until you can get a job and pay for the premium again.
this may be the subject of the next book, but there, you know, healthcare is just in the context of a much broader society, and people's self-esteem and family security are tied more to jobs and unemployment and paying bills than they are to having insurance or health care. So, and in the United States versus the United States of Europe, in the United States of Europe, there are different models as you described here in our country. My question, or I guess my posit is, when you take deficits and deficit spending that's associated with these different health cares, and you try to attach that, as the OECD has in some studies, to the stickiness or the chronic unemployment, which is a real issue for all the young people here and the middle-aged people. What models, and I don't know that there's an answer to this, but what models might serve the best? Now my premise is that Singapore may have the best model. It is all private, and the context there, and perhaps should be here, is not that we cover everybody, but we cover the poor, the people that don't have the means to provide insurance. And that I disagree with you about everyone being equal, but nevertheless, we cover the people that don't have insurance. Then, if we can do that in an effective way without spending deficit or huge public transfers of funds that affect employment, is there a model or can there be a model that can achieve those two things? Because I think if you ask the 30,000 GM workers that just lost their jobs, if they would, in hindsight, you can't do this, but in hindsight, would their self-esteem and their family security be better by having given up much of, not all, but much of their health care and continued their jobs? I would imagine a very high percentage of them would vote for giving up some of their health care and continuing their jobs. So it is not just the context of health care, it's deficits.
Okay, I think he understands it.
Yeah, I hear you, but I don't share your premise. If your argument is that providing health care for everybody increases government deficits, no, that's wrong. They all spend less than we do. They spend half as much as we do to cover everybody. So if you cover everybody, you're going to spend less and run up less of a deficit. It just doesn't follow that they have bigger deficits because of health care. They spend less on health care than we do. And as for that GM employee who would have given up health care to keep his job, what if we said to him, well, give up your vote and you can keep your job? Would you allow that? What if we said to them, we're going to cut your taxes so your kids can't go to public school, but you can keep your job? Would you make them make that choice? What I'm saying is, in other countries, they wouldn't impose that choice on anybody, but they don't have to. They don't have to, because I just don't buy your basic premise. The notion that providing health care for everybody increases deficits is not right. They spend less on health care than we do. They're more competitive than we are while providing health care for everybody. And the argument in my book is, if we were willing to learn from those other countries, we could do the same. Thanks so much for coming.